Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Tragedy of Empire, From Constantine to the Destruction of Roman Italy, by Michael Kulikowski, narrated by Simon Shepherd.
Introduction. In February or March 360, the senior Roman emperor, the Augustus Constantius II, sent a perfectly reasonable command to his cousin and junior emperor, the Caesar Julian. Rome was at war with Persia, and the last time the two sides had clashed, just a year before, the Romans had suffered a disaster. The Persian king Shapur had assaulted the strategic city of Amida on the Tigris River, now Diyarbakir in southeastern Turkey. After months of siege, the city's walls had been breached, and the Persian forces had poured in, annihilating the garrison and slaughtering those civilians they did not take into captivity. The great king had only been prevented from pressing further into Roman territory by the coming of autumn and the end of the campaigning season, but he would surely strike again and harder as soon as winter was over. Preparing to lead the next effort against Shapur in person, Constantius moved from his Balkan headquarters to Antioch, the metropolis, the provincial capital of Roman Syria. Julian's task was to govern the Roman West. But whatever police actions he might need to undertake on the Rhine frontier were clearly a comparatively minor problem, and Constantius required him to send four whole infantry units, along with a levy of 300 men from every other unit in the Gallic field army. As senior emperor, Constantius was well within his rights to make this demand. His assessment of the respective threats was also entirely accurate. Julian's clear duty was to obey. He chose not to. Instead, he decided to usurp the title of Augustus, setting himself up as a senior emperor and his cousin's equal, knowing full well that civil war would follow. Julian had been campaigning annually along the Roman frontier on the Rhine and Upper Danube, ever since his cousin had summoned him out of enforced leisure studying philosophy in Athens in 355. No love was lost between the two men. Julian had been a very young child when his father and nearly all his male relatives had been slaughtered in 337 in a massacre that Constantius had engineered. As one of three sons of the Emperor Constantine I, who had remade the empire in his image and defined its future, Constantius refused to countenance Constantine's half-brothers and their offspring, sharing in the inheritance of empire. He had carried his full brothers, Constantine II, the elder, and Constans, the younger, with him, but it was Constantius who pruned the family's collateral branches so they could never challenge the sons of Constantine himself. Julian had nurtured his revenge for a long, long time. All the while, he expected a sudden blow to fall, assassination or execution if Constantius's notorious paranoia were to flare up. At no time had he expected so much as a glimpse at imperial power. But chance played its part. Constantius's brothers had quarreled and gone to war, Constantine II dying in battle. Constans, the survivor, shared Constantius's piety and assertiveness, but lacked his political insight and shrewd sense of self-advantage. He fell to a usurper in 350, whom Constantius suppressed 3 years later. Realizing that he could not compel sufficient loyalty to govern his vast empire alone, Constantius hauled from retirement Julian's half-brother Gallus, the only other male relative to survive the 337 massacre, also on account of his extreme youth. Ruling by preference from the Balkans, Constantius sent Gallus to govern the east from Antioch, having made him Caesar, junior emperor, and presumptive heir. But Gallus proved unsuitable. As paranoid as his imperial cousin, he was also a braggart and a bully, and he made himself hated very quickly. His political ineptitude meant he lacked all defense against the seductive courtiers and plausible whisperers who fanned the senior emperor's suspicions. In 354, Gallus was summoned back to his cousin's court and summarily executed en route at Pola, now Pula, in Croatian Istria. Unloved though he was, Gallus had served a function, and Constantius could no more rule the empire alone in 354 than he could the year before. Julian was the solution, urged on Constantius by his wife Eusebia. The emperor was reluctant. He had wronged Julian badly and repeatedly, and must have suspected the younger man's hatred, even though it had never been vented in public. But he had no choice. Constantius sent officials to watch Julian and made every effort to keep the young Caesar on a tight lead, while he brought home military successes from Gaul that were real enough. And Julian inspired genuine affection in his officers and enthusiasm from his troops, having a charisma of which, by all contemporary accounts, Constantius was utterly devoid. As with Gallus, so with Julian, and things were never likely to end happily. The Caesar would undoubtedly have manufactured an excuse for usurpation regardless of the circumstances. Constantius's levy on the Gallic military establishment was a lucky gift, a fig leaf to cover naked ambition and well-tended resentment. But the coup had already been prepared. Since moving to Gaul, Julian had preferred to winter at Lutetia, now Paris, rather than at one of the traditional imperial residences at Treveri, Lugdunum, or Arelati, Trier, Lyon, and Arles, respectively. Lutetia was at some distance from the hotspots of the Gallic frontier, but, more importantly, it was also at a good distance from the civilian administration of the Gallic provinces, which was studded with men more loyal to the distant senior emperor than to the Caesar close at hand. No one had objected when Julian took himself and his personal guard units, the Scholae Palatini and Protectores Domestici, to Lutetia in previous winters. But in the winter of 359, more confident of getting away with it, he had brought with him not just his guardsmen, but four units of the field army as well. Anyone with eyes to see would have understood what that implied. For the rest of his life, Julian insisted on a most traditional denial. The soldiers had spontaneously demanded that he take the rank of Augustus, and he had accepted only with the deepest reluctance. This was not true. Not just the units at hand in Lutetia, but the whole Gallic army stood by him when they heard the news. They must have been waiting for it since moving into their winter quarters. This was how politics worked in the 4th century empire. Gaul, its army and its bureaucracy had become very used to conducting itself with real autonomy and in its own interests, whether or not these matched the will of the senior emperor. That had been true even in the reign of Constantine, but similar regional establishments were visible in the Balkans and the East by early in the reign of Constantius. While capable of working towards a common imperial goal, the regional factions nonetheless put their own priorities and those of their big men first. It was not in the Gallic interest to lose a substantial portion of the field army, so Julian became the natural choice for emperor and could be expected to act in the interests of the Gallic high command. By his own intemperate standards, Constantius reacted to the news with circumspection. He rejected Julian's suggestion that he be permitted to hold the title of Augustus in the west, while remaining a mere Caesar in the east, and did not immediately threaten Julian with Gallus's fate. Yet, deprived by Julian of his western levies, Constantius could only watch as Shapur's armies took Singara and Bezabda, fortress cities at the extreme eastern edge of Roman territory, razing the former, now Sinjar in Iraq, to the ground in the summer of 360. In winter 360-61, Roman armies retook Bezabda, but this back and forth presaged more fighting to come. Obeying an iron law of Roman history, that internal usurpation always trumps foreign threat, Constantius decided to confront his rebellious cousin, who had escalated his original offense in November 360, when celebrating the quinquennalia, fifth anniversary of his accession as Caesar at Vienna, modern Vienne in France, Julian not only decked himself in full Augustal panoply, he also minted gold coins under the title of Augustus. Minting was a closely guarded privilege, the chief public medium through which emperors communicated their intentions to their troops, their officials, and one another. For Julian to strike coins as Augustus was effectively to declare war. As winter broke early in 361, Julian manufactured a casus belli of his own. The Alamanni were a disparate group of barbarians who lived beside the imperial frontier on the Upper Danube, which is now southwestern Germany. One of their kings, Vadomarius, was known to be a personal client of Constantius, and Julian now accused him of plotting to attack the Gallic provinces. Plausible or not, the charge was enough to justify mobilizing the whole of the Gallic field army, ostensibly for a punitive expedition beyond the frontier. In reality, for a much bolder move, a lightning invasion of the Balkans that would confine Constantius to the eastern provinces beyond the narrow gorge on the Danube, known as the Iron Gates, and the Suchy Pass between Serdica and Philippopolis, Sofia and Plovdiv in modern Bulgaria. Julian, with a field army under his personal command, marched down the Danube, transshipping part of his force downriver in advance. His most trusted general, the Magister Equitum, Flavius Nevita, took the great military road along the Sava River, seizing Siscia and Sirmium, Sisak in Croatia and Sremska Mitrovica in Serbia. The Balkan garrison forces that had not gone east with Constantius to fight the Persians went over to Julian, who sent a handful of units back into Italy through Emona, Ljubljana in Slovenia, and over the Julian Alps, with the intention of taking the North Italian plain. The success had been quite stunning, until two of Julian's legions repelled on their way into Italy, switching their allegiance to Constantius and seizing control of the stronghold of Aquileia, nowadays a tiny town and major archaeological site in the Italian province of Udine, but then one of the empire's dozen or so largest cities. With these newly hostile forces behind him, Julian might need to contemplate war on two fronts, and he could no longer be sure of his supply lines to the loyal Gallic provinces. He halted at Sirmium, while trusted generals took part of the Gallic garrison through the Alps and seized the main cities on the Italian plain. From Sirmium, he began to pepper the eastern provinces with missives. He had been educated in Greek and fancied himself as a philosopher, in which he accused Constantius of serially wronging him. He hoped to turn elite public opinion his way, trusting that a shared vocabulary of Hellenistic high culture would count for more with them than did Constantius's dour Christian piety. Julian had not yet made public his apostasy from the Christianity in which he had been raised, but one can sense in his letters a visceral hostility to a religion of peace that had nevertheless countenanced the slaughter of his birth family. Constantius, his vanity pricked, must surely have felt the psychological blow of Julian's taunting, while the military challenge he posed was real enough. There was no alternative now but to leave the eastern provinces to the mercy of the Persian king and set out against his rebel Caesar. Constantius left Antioch at the head of his army in October 361, moving fast to get clear of the Anatolian highlands before winter. He had made it no further than Cilicia when sickness overtook him. Sensing that his illness was mortal, Constantius decided to die a statesman. Throughout his reign, since the massacre of 337, with which he inaugurated it, he had let raison d'état guide him, as well as a reptilian coldness that was strangely self-abnegating. On the 3rd of November 361, he acknowledged Julian as his co-Augustus, and thus his legitimate successor, and died the same day. That, at any rate, was the official story. And though it might have been concocted by Constantius's high command to forestall further conflict, the gesture would not have been out of keeping with what we know of Constantius's character. Be that as it may, with his cousin's death, Julian began his sole reign as the last male survivor of the Constantian dynasty, and one determined to dismantle the social and political revolution his great-uncle Constantine had worked on the Roman world. The conflict between Julian and Constantius illustrates many of the themes and structural features of the late Roman history more generally. It shows the tensions inherent in the collegial rule of senior and junior emperors, but also its necessity for governing a sprawling territory with pre-modern communications. It shows the scale of the imperial state apparatus, military and civilian, and the demands made on it by continual warfare. It shows, too, how regional factions, made up of interlocking networks of military and civilian families, were in many ways more important than any individual emperor in determining the fortunes of the state. Finally, it reveals the social transformation of an empire that was not yet Christian, but that had long since abandoned the religious laissez-faire of its first 2.5 centuries. This distinctively late Roman Empire, and the way its political economy developed and eventually disappeared, is the main subject of this audiobook. For the listener to make sense of it, we need, very briefly, to jump back in time from the death of Constantius II to two emblematic moments. The year 324, when Constantine made himself sole ruler of the empire, and the year 284, when Diocletian seized the imperial purple. Chapter 1. The Making of the Constantinian Empire. In the year 324, the Western Augustus Constantine decisively defeated in battle the Eastern Augustus Licinius, his sometime ally and brother-in-law, now turned deadly rival. With that victory, Constantine made himself sole ruler of the Roman Empire. The pair of them had survived a series of bloody civil wars earlier in the century, when the governmental system that we know as the tetrarchy fell apart. This tetrarchy, ruled by four men, was created in the year 293 by the Emperor Diocletian. Conceived as an attempt to resolve the persistent crises that plagued the Roman political elite and army during the 3rd century, it had been largely successful. Diocletian had acknowledged that an empire stretching from the Atlantic to the Euphrates and from the Rhine and the Tyne to the Sahara could not be ruled effectively by a single man. Having come to power in a military coup after the reigning emperor was assassinated on campaign in Mesopotamia, Diocletian then defeated that emperor's son in the Balkans and received the grudging acceptance of the Roman Senate, a body that retained symbolic, if not actual, power. That kind of path to the throne had been the 3rd century norm, with rival armies proclaiming their own commanders emperor, each then fighting to impose control on the whole of the empire. The pattern had begun in the 230s for a variety of reasons. One was the appearance of new, more powerful enemies on several frontiers, particularly new barbarian coalitions on the Rhine, Franks, and the Rhine-Upper Danube, Alamanni, and a new Persian dynasty that overthrew the Parthian rulers whom the Romans had long known. This new dynasty, called Sasanian after its mythical founder, was less Hellenized and less familiar to the Romans than the Parthians had been, and also much more aggressive. The Sasanian Shahanshahs, kings of kings, were believers in the dualistic Zoroastrian religion and fervent supporters of its priesthood, and this faith gave a sense of mission to their wars of conquest, not least against the eastern provinces of the Roman Empire. Repeatedly in the 3rd century, and especially if the reigning emperor was far away, some kind of foreign threat would produce a usurpation, as a local commander was made emperor in order to confront the danger. And because usurpation was intrinsically worse for a ruling emperor's survival than any foreign invasion could be, usurpations always took priority over any other challenges. The consequence was continuous civil war. That said, the existential crisis of the Roman ruling class was about more than just endemic civil war. It was also about social and dynastic transformation, something that civil war could exacerbate but not cause all on its own. For the first 100 years of its history, the Roman imperial system, founded by Augustus, had rested on magistrates drawn from the ranks of the Roman Senate. what had once been the governing body of the old republic, became a sort of incubator for provincial administrators and military commanders, though it was no longer meaningfully independent of the emperor. The ranks of this ordo senatorius, the Romans thought in terms of ordines, orders, distinguished by privileges and duties rather than social classes, were swelled by the granting of Roman citizenship to more and more of the empire's population. When a provincial community was enfranchised, the richest of its local elites became eligible to join the Senate. And we find non-Italian senators emerging first from southern Gaul and southern and eastern Spain, then from the heart of the Hellenistic world in Greece, the islands, and Asia Minor, and finally from Africa, and a few urban patches in the northern provinces. But however fast the Senate might grow, its numbers would never be sufficient to serve the many tasks for which magistrates were needed: tax collection, the administration of justice, maintaining public infrastructures, suppressing banditry, and so on. The vast expansion of the emperor's own wealth and lands, distinct from the land and property of the Roman state, meant that the slaves and freedmen of the imperial household were, for many decades, used for everything from estate management to taxation. Soon, however, the second tier of the Roman ruling class, known as the ordo equester or equestrians, became the main actors in imperial administration. As the second and third centuries progressed, the government of the empire became more regularized, more bureaucratic, and more professional, with the overwhelming majority of administrative posts filled by the equestrian order. At the same time, the army became more flexible in its system of promotions. So, men who started as common soldiers could acquire equestrian rank and join the officer corps. Eventually, and certainly by the middle of the 3rd century, such men had crowded senators out of most command positions. By the time that Diocletian put an end to 50 years of civil war, no vestiges of the old senatorial aristocracy remained. In the 4th century, even the oldest and most esteemed families, even those in the city of Rome, with perhaps two exceptions, could trace their line back only to the crisis years of the 3rd century. Diocletian was in many ways a revolutionary, but not in his treatment of the governing classes, which retained the old distinction of senatorial and equestrian ranks. It was Constantine who acknowledged that any meaningful distinction in the functions performed by each group had disappeared de facto, merging the equestrian order with the senatorial and ensuring that the senatorial aristocracy of the 4th century would be a very different thing from its early imperial counterpart. In most other respects, however, Constantine inherited an empire that had been fundamentally reshaped by Diocletian, and this baseline structure is the stage on which this audiobook's narrative plays out. During the 290s, Diocletian had broken the very large provinces of the earlier empire into more than 100 smaller ones, each with a civilian governor and many with some sort of military establishment. His goal had been to reduce the danger of usurpation by shrinking the resources available to any potential rebel and separating the function of commanding troops from that of supplying and paying them. The main evidence for the Diocletianic provinces is a bureaucratic document from around 312, known as the Laticulis Veronensis, Verona List. This names the more than 100 provinces into which the empire was divided, each of which had its own governor. These officials had different titles: proconsul, consularis, corrector. And as the 4th century progressed, a definite hierarchy of prestige emerged among the different provincial commands. Proconsuls governed Africa proconsularis, roughly modern Tunisia, Asia, the northwestern corner of modern Turkey, and Achaia, Greece and the Aegean Islands, because those three provinces had been the most distinguished commands since the earliest days of the empire. In fact, later in the 4th century, the proconsuls would be given the special legal privilege of reporting directly to the emperor rather than to any official of higher administrative rank. Unlike proconsul, the titles of consularis and curector did not in themselves indicate higher or lower rank. But some provinces, usually the more urbanized ones in regions that had been part of the empire longer, were definitely better regarded than others. The tenure of a governorship in, say, southern Italy, thus became a good indicator of future career success. Regardless of their title, however, the various governors all played the same role, overseeing the civilian administration of their provinces, including both the legal system and the province's obligation to the various financial bureaus of the state. The 100 or so provinces, the number and borders of which were occasionally rearranged, were also grouped into larger units. Called dioceses, these groups of provinces tended to be quite stable and were in many ways the real building blocks of 4th century government. Originally, under Diocletian and the Tetrarchs, their main function was fiscal, joining together provinces that were subject to a particular hierarchy of tax officials. Constantine systemized diocesan governance under officials called vicarii, who had the authority to judge legal cases vicae sacra, that is to say, in the imperial stead. His goal was not only to make the administration of justice more uniform, but also to ensure that different layers of provincial and diocesan jurisdiction would overlap and potentially duplicate one another's work. That duplication and an intentional lack of clarity about whose decisions could be appealed and to whom such appeals should be made was meant to encourage the various officials to keep an eye on each other, surveillance and delation being good ways to hold officials in check at a distance from the imperial court. The original Diocletianic diocese remained largely intact until the empire began to fragment in the 5th century, though Constantine created two Balkan dioceses, Dacia and Macedonia, where there had previously been one. Later, Valens made Egypt its own diocese, separating it from the vast dioceses of Oriens, the east, which stretched from Armenia and the Taurus to Arabia and Palestine. These two large dioceses were also distinguished by the odd titles of their vicarii, the vicarius of Egypt known as the praefectus augustalis, and that of the east as the comes orientis. The diocese was in many ways the most critical level of imperial government, being the largest chunk of territory that could usefully be run as a single fiscal unit. Despite their importance, the vicarii never gained inappellate legal powers, because above them stood the most important civilian officials in late imperial government, the praetorian prefects. These late imperial prefects were the direct descendants of an office that went right back to the foundation of the empire. Originally, a pair of prefects had commanded the praetorian guard, the privileged military force garrisoned in Rome itself. Very quickly, however, as the highest equestrian officers in the state and frequent surrogates for the emperor himself, they had come to exercise authority over many corners of the civilian government. Their function had begun to change in the 3rd century, and their military function was definitively ended by Constantine, who also suppressed the Praetorian Guard after it supported a rival in a civil war. Under the Tetrarchy, each emperor had had his own praetorian prefect, and that practice continued under Constantine when he gave his children subordinate courts of their own. These prefects, whose number varied with the number of subordinate emperors, Caesars, remained the most powerful officials in the imperial state. They could offer inappellable legal judgments in the emperor's stead. They supervised the collection and disbursement of revenues from the dioceses under their authority, and they heard appeals against lower-ranking regional officials. Their financial responsibilities were enormous because they were in charge of the annona, all the pay and rations of the imperial civil service and the army. The Roman Empire was, at every stage of its existence, a machine for redistributing taxes in cash or in kind from the provinces to the army and the civilian administration. Indeed, late Latin uses the same word, militia, to designate service in both the military and the civilian hierarchies. Private shipping networks hitched themselves to the official networks of the Annona. One reason, the late imperial state was essential to a functioning commercial economy. Along with control of that vast financial machine, the prefects saw to the imperial infrastructure, maintained the public postal system, and levied taxes in cash, in kind or in conscription, and corvées, unpaid labour, to ensure the upkeep of that infrastructure. By the time of Constantine's death in 337, we can observe the de facto territorialization of the Praetorian prefecture. This became the de jure norm in the time of Constantine's sons, particularly after his middle son, Constantius II, became sole legitimate emperor in 350. Though the dioceses that pertained to particular prefectures might shift at times, and did so frequently in the latter 4th and early 5th centuries thanks to civil wars and invasions, four relatively stable prefectures grew up by around 350. Gallia, generally administered from Treveri, and taking in the four dioceses of Britannia, Hispania, Gallia Narbonensis, Gaul south of the Loire, and Tres Galliae, Gaul and Germany north of the Loire and west of the Rhine, a prefecture of Italy and Africa, taking in the two Italian dioceses, Italia Annonaria north of Rome and Suburbicaria in the south. Latin-speaking Africa west of Cyrene, the Alpine provinces and sometimes Pannonia, Hungary, Austria and parts of Slovenia and Croatia, Illyricum, which was sometimes administered jointly with Italy and Africa and took in Macedonia, Dacia and often Pannonia as well, and finally a prefecture of the east taking in Thrace, Asiana, Asia Minor, Oriens, the Taurus, the Levant and Mesopotamia, and Egypt. As marks of their privilege, the provinces of Achaia, Asia and Africa proconsularis were exempted from their respective prefect's authority, though in practice they needed to work with his administration in financial matters. Rome itself was subject to the praefectus urbi, urban prefect, a highly prestigious senatorial post, and the praefectus annoni, generally a lower-ranking official with connections to the praetorian prefect. Constantine's new city of Constantinople, which became a second Rome in the course of the 4th century, was separated from Thrace and given its own independent praefectus urbi by Constantius in 359. Each governor, vicarius, and prefect had a staff reaching into the dozens, sometimes into the hundreds, but even they were a relatively small element in the apparatus of imperial government. The palatine bureaus that operated in the imperial presence were known collectively as the comitatus, literally the group of companions, and these travelled with the emperor between the various imperial residences. The household staff were known as cubicularii, and they served under a praepositus sacri cubiculi, or head of the sacred bedchamber. Nearly all praepositi were eunuchs, generally from the borderlands between Rome and Persia, where legal prohibitions on castrating Romans did not apply. They supervised the palace accounts, attended to the intimate needs of the emperor and his wife, and supervised a staff of teachers, clerks, and servants collectively known as the ministerialis or curae palatiorum. The other bureaus of the comitatus dealt with the emperor's public functions. The magister officiorum, master of the offices, was the most powerful of these bureau chiefs, in charge of the various scrinia, departments, required to cover the emperor's public roles. His staff of three junior magistri, memoriae, libellorum, and epistularum, handled imperial correspondence, received the appeals and petitions addressed to the emperor, and the relationes, official reports of provincial administrators, and then drafted responses to them. The bureau maintained a corps of translators for diplomatic purposes, and the magister officiorum also controlled the confidential courier system of imperial government, which was staffed by roughly 1,000 agentes in rebus, doers of things. These agentes started their careers as messengers, but very frequently ended up becoming highly confidential spies and assassins, doing the kind of dirty work that all governments need to have done with quiet expedition. In another sign of his very extensive powers, the Magister Officiorum was the only civilian official in late Roman government with command of troops. As the titular head of the emperor's household forces, the scholae palatini. Each scholar, how many of these there were at any given time is disputed, consisted of 500 elite cavalry under the commander of an officer known as a tribunus, appointed personally by the emperor. The emperor drew his personal bodyguards, who were called candidati because of their white uniforms, from the scholae. Another Palatine bureau, the Corps of Notaries, duplicated some of the functions also carried out by the bureau of the Magister Officiorum. The Notarii, under the Primicarius Notoriarum, kept track of official appointments across the length and breadth of the empire and drew up the imperial commissioning letters. The Primicarius Notoriarum was responsible for maintaining the master list, the Laticulum Maius of every imperial officeholder. But while notarii were technically mere clerks, they were often, like the agentes in rebus, seconded to more dubious special operations as spies and interrogators. Though the praetorian prefects oversaw the largest sums of money circulating through the state systems, Constantine had also inherited two Palatine financial bureaus from the governmental reforms of Diocletian, each of them supervised by a comes, here translated as count rather than companion. The bureau of the res privata, whose comes rei privati, always travelled with the senior emperor, supervised five different scrinia handling various aspects of the emperor's personal properties, from taxation and rent to sale and forfeitures to the crown. These functions meant that the agents of the res privata required large establishments in every province. The other financial bureau in the comitatus was the sacrae largitiones, sacred largesses, whose comes sacrarum largitionum controlled the imperial mints, the most important of which were at Rome, Treveri, Arelate, Sirmium, Serdica, Thessalonica, Antioch, and Alexandria. After years of financial instability, Constantine had refounded the Roman monetary system on the basis of a very pure gold coin, weighing 4.5 grams and known as the solidus. Silver and base metal coins continued to be minted for use in small transactions, but they were not pegged at a fixed rate to the solidus, and the fiscal side of the imperial economy was based entirely upon gold. The sacrae largitiones also ran the state's gold and silver mines and supervised the fabricae, or state factories, where weapons and armour for the officer corps were adorned with precious metals. The Magister Officiorum looked after the fabricae in which the unadorned versions were manufactured. Finally, the bureau was the destination for all taxes collected in silver or gold. These included various tolls and harbour taxes. The Aurum Tyrannicum, a tax that commuted a levy of military conscripts into gold, the Aurum Coronarium, the voluntary donation that towns made to an emperor upon his accession and then at each fifth year anniversary, the Aurum Oblaticum, paid by senators on the same calendar, the Collatio Globalis, an annual fee paid by senators, the Collatio Lustralis, or Chrysargyron in Greek, a tax on all tradespeople from shopkeepers to prostitutes, levied every 5 years originally in gold or silver, later only in gold. There were fully 10 scrinia in the bureau of the comes sacrarum largitionum, and, as with the res privata, these operated everywhere at the provincial level as well as in the comitatus. Apart from the bureau of the Magister Officiorum with his scholae palatini, Constantine had definitively separated the empire's military hierarchy from the civilian, formalizing the very strong third-century trend towards that outcome. The field army, known as the comitatenses, was made up of numerous units of roughly 1,000 men each. Many provinces, especially along the frontiers, also had their own garrison armies, known as limitinae or repensis. many of which were units descended from the much larger Roman legions of the early empire. The field army was commanded by two generals who usually travelled with the emperor's comitatus and were thus known as Magistri Militum Praesentales in the imperial presence. The senior commander was called the Magister Peditum Praesentales, while the junior commander was called the Magister Equitum Praesentales, which translates as commander of the infantry and commander of the horse, respectively, even though both the Magister Peditum and the Magister Equitum led both infantry and cavalry and were generically known as Magistri Militum, masters of soldiers. If several emperors were ruling in an imperial college, these commands would be duplicated in each comitatus, although over time, and in parallel to the development of regional prefectures, there came to be regional command establishments for the comitatenses. Along with the praesental magistri, by the mid-4th century, there tended to be a magister per gallias, one per Illyricum and one per Orientum, each with a more or less stable corps of comitatenses that might fluctuate depending upon military conditions in the region. The permanent garrison armies on the frontiers were commanded by comites or duces, with a variety of limitani at their disposal, although these units were sometimes dispersed widely throughout a province and often functioned as much as policemen and customs officials as soldiers. Separately from the comitatenses and the limitani, a corps of protectores domestici was recruited from the privileged and well-connected children of civil servants and the military hierarchy, and from high-born young men from client states on the frontiers. These soldiers attended the emperor's personal military commands, and the scholae domesticiorum served as a training corps for the men of very diverse backgrounds who joined the late imperial officer class. The protectores domestici served under a comes domesticiorum, who was a senior member of the comitatus. Another group of regular protectores were common soldiers promoted towards the end of their careers and assigned managerial posts, often in distant provinces, as a reward for long service. In later chapters, we will see how the Constantinian governmental system, sketched out briefly here, functioned in practice, constraining what emperors and their subjects could and could not do. But important though they are, the structures of government were not the only way in which Constantine remade the empire. He also began the process, soon to become irreversible, by which it became Christian. Christianity had started out as a dissenting Jewish sect, but had, by the second century, come to regard itself as a new religion worshipping the single jealous God who had sent his son Jesus to redeem mankind. At first confined to small communities in rural Palestine and the cities of the Greek East, Christianity had, by the middle of the 3rd century, spread widely. That is, at one level, quite surprising, because Christianity was a peculiar religion by ancient standards. Greeks and Romans had long understood the exclusive monotheism of the Jews and their refusal to countenance other gods, including those of the Roman state, as an exceptional phenomenon. Tolerated because it was so clearly a minority faith and one confined to a restricted ethnic community. Christian exclusivity was different, though, both from Judaism and the other religions of the Greco-Roman world, in that what made it efficacious was belief, not ritual actions. Non-Christians might have very elaborate and philosophical beliefs about the true nature of the universe and the divine, or they might have little more than a jumble of unreflective superstitions, but all understood that acts of sacrifice were the duty that men owed the gods, whether at huge public festivals in which hundreds of animals were offered up, or as an individual dropping a pinch of incense on an altar. For the Jews of this period, the correct observation of prayer and ritual behaviors served the same function. Christians could not take part in public festivals for fear of forfeiting their prospect of salvation, since their jealous God forbade them, nor were they to honour the gods of the Roman state, or the cult of the divine emperors in a taboo that could be interpreted as treasonable. Refusal to sacrifice had led to several episodes of mass persecution by imperial authorities during the 3rd century. After the second of these, the Emperor Gallienus granted toleration to Christians and recognized the right of Christian churches to own property under Roman law, as a result of which the number of Christians increased rapidly in the latter half of the 3rd century. Despite many confident assertions to the contrary, we will never have any good sense of actual numbers, nor even ballpark figures. Our evidence is just not good enough. Still, by the year 300, Christians may have made up a majority of the population in parts of the Greek-speaking East, while being at most a substantial minority population in the Latin West. For the educated elites of both the Greek and Latin worlds, Christianity was just one option among many. Indeed, just one monotheistic option among many, given the popularity of philosophico-religious systems like Neoplatonism that had also a strongly monotheist element to them. For the mass of the population, Christian worship existed alongside the public festivals of the gods and the pervasive folk beliefs of the countryside. Christianity was not yet a majority belief at any level of the social hierarchy, and there is no truth in the pious old idea that it appealed especially or exclusively to the poor and humble elements in society. Christian communities had become too varied, not to mention too wealthy and successful, for that to have been true. By roughly the same point in the late 3rd century, a clear hierarchy of clerical grades had developed within Christian communities, and their leaders, the bishops, episcopi, formed a network that reached right across the Roman world, and indeed beyond it, into the Christian communities of Mesopotamia who lived under Persian rule. Certain bishops exercised greater authority than their neighbors, either from personal charisma, the antiquity of their city's episcopal see, or simply their city's size and importance in the grander scheme of things, or indeed for all three reasons, as at Carthage in Africa Proconsularis. A handful of sees, Rome, Alexandria, and Antioch, claimed the right to speak for and to Christians, not just in their region or province, but everywhere. They did so on the basis of their great antiquity and apostolic foundation, that is, their claim to have been founded by one of Jesus' companions and the first proselytes of his message. Christianity was thus an accepted part of the empire's religious landscape by 303, the year in which Diocletian launched the last persecution of Christians, the Great Persecution, aimed at rooting out the religion altogether as a threat to public order and an affront to the gods who protected the Roman state. The grounds for this persecution and the events that sparked it are simply too complex to be discussed here, inextricably tied up as they were with the internal political machinations of the tetrarchs and their families. But from 303 to 305, Christians across the empire experienced some form of persecution, from the destruction of their churches and burning of Christian books in parts of the Latin West, to extensive confiscations, torture, and executions in Africa and the Greek East. In the West, persecution stopped in 305, but in the East, it persisted in one shape or another up until 313. By then, it had become a volatile factor in the civil wars that ended the Tetrarchy, not least because of Constantine's own conversion to Christianity, which was to turn out to be one of the most momentous events in world history. Constantine may well have been sympathetic to Christianity from a very early age. There were Christians in his family, and his father, the Caesar Constantius, had enforced Diocletian's persecuting edict as lightly as he could get away with in the parts of the empire he controlled. In fact, one of the many motives for the persecution may have been to knock Constantine out of the succession plan of the Tetrarchs. But when Constantius died, his soldiers proclaimed his son emperor, and Diocletian's successor, Galerius, now the senior Augustus, grudgingly recognized Constantine as a legitimate member of the Imperial College. Between 306 and 312, the 6 years in which he ruled Gaul, Britain, and Spain, Constantine tried to reverse as many of the consequences of the persecution as he could in those lands. And he did the same after he seized Italy and Africa from his rival, Maxentius in the year 312. By that point, he had openly declared himself a Christian. Up until 312, he had had both the traditional priests of the state cults and Christian priests in his comitatus, among them Bishop Hosius or Ossius of Cordoba in modern Andalusia. They had provided him with rival explanations of a celestial vision he had seen in the company of his campaign army in the year 310. What this was has been much debated, but it was perhaps an optical phenomenon known as a solar halo, in which light interacting with the ice crystals in clouds creates what looks like circles or pillars in the sky. Be that as it may, everyone could agree that the heavens had sent Constantine a message. The only question was what they might have meant by it. Was it Apollo, god of the sun, promising Constantine victory? Or was it a sign from the one true and only God, as Hosius and his Christian fellows argued? Perhaps Constantine thought he could have it both ways, but then, when he invaded Italy in 312, decisively defeating Maxentius's field armies in the North Italian plain before marching on to Rome, he had a dream on the night before the final battle. This directed him to paint a Christogram, that is, the Greek letter chi, superimposed on the letter rho and standing for Christus, on his men's shields, and march into battle under the protection of the Christian God. This he did. Maxentius's forces were duly vanquished, and the usurper drowned in the Tiber. Constantine would return to this story of his conversion often in later life, and he clearly rewrote or perhaps reinterpreted what had happened many times over. But it is clear that from 312 onwards, he ruled as a consciously Christian emperor and actively favoured Christian churches whenever he could. He swiftly learned that this meant not just limitless successes, but daunting challenges as well. In 312, almost as soon as Maxentius was dead, the Christian emperor was asked to intervene in a dispute between Christians. Persecution had created a terrible schism in the North African church. Some maintained that priests and bishops had forfeited their legitimacy and were no longer priests if they had handed over Christian scriptures to the persecuting authorities. They were dubbed traditores, which means those who hand things over, and is the root of our English word traitor. Not only could they themselves not be priests or bishops, but no one they had ordained or consecrated could be a priest or a bishop either. The immediate dispute centered on whether the newly elected Bishop of Carthage, Sicilianus, could legitimately hold that office because the bishop who had consecrated him was alleged to have been a traditor. Sicilianus's opponents had elected a rival bishop, Donatus, and both sides now appealed to Constantine. The emperor sought advice from Miltiades, the bishop of Rome, who in 313 ruled against the Donatists, as Donatus's supporters came to be called. They again appealed the judgment, and Constantine summoned a council of Western bishops to meet at Arelate in 314. Episcopal councils had, for some time, been the favoured means of resolving disputes within the church, but their success depended on the willingness of the losing side to accept conciliar judgment, which was anything but a given. Thus, when the bishops who had assembled at Arelate ruled against Donatius and supported the legitimacy of Sicilianus, the Donatists refused to comply with the order to depose their bishop, still insisting that he was the only true claimant to the see. Constantine, an autocrat by temperament as well as position, instructed his officials to suppress the recalcitrants by force. Some Donatists were martyred, some went into exile, but state violence merely drove the schism underground, resolving nothing. Donatus and his partisans continued to consecrate rival bishops in African towns and villages, and the conflict between Sicilianists and Donatists suppurated for more than 100 years, long after Constantine's death. Yet, stubbornly persistent, though the Donatist schism would remain, the dispute was fundamentally a conflict over discipline and legitimacy, and its roots were firmly tied to their local context. By contrast, when Christians contested theological points, salvation and the life eternal were at stake, and the ramifications were consequently much greater. Constantine would discover this the hard way not long after he snatched the Eastern Empire from Licinius in 324. The conflict between Constantine and Licinius could have been avoided had the former's lust for power not been insatiable. Licinius showed every sign of being content to rule the Eastern Empire while Constantine ruled the Western, but Constantine provoked a conflict in 316, winning decisively and taking over most of the Balkans when the two sides reached a peace agreement. By the early 320s, Constantine was again deliberately provoking his fellow emperor, and their final breach came in 323 when Constantine violated Licinius's territory while ostensibly prosecuting a war against the Sarmatians beyond the Danube. A final reckoning was inevitable, and Constantine's forces were again victorious. Routed, Licinius fled to Asia Minor and his army surrendered to Constantine. After being promised his life in return for unconditional surrender, Licinius was imprisoned at Thessalonica and executed not long afterwards, accused of plotting against a merciful emperor who had, so it was claimed, dearly wanted to spare his life. Constantine had already fought his Western War of Conquest under a Christian banner 12 years earlier, but in 324 he could actually portray Licinius as a persecutor. The Eastern Emperor had, in fact, ordered measures against Christians in his territory as a means of retaliating against Constantine's aggressions, but that meant Constantine could spin his war of conquest as a Christian duty. In the aftermath of total victory, he made it clear that he was going to rule as a Christian, not merely favoring Christians as he did in the West, but actively attempting to impose Christianity on the non-Christian communities of the East, and deliberately undermining the power of non-Christian cults. He also got himself deeply entangled in the theological politics of the Greek churches, fueled by a supremely arrogant confidence in his ability to fix what was, in reality, unfixable. The Christianity of the Greek East was rather different from the Latin Christianity of the West, and its ecclesiastical politics vastly more complicated. What is more, the East, where there had been a much larger Christian population to start with, had suffered much harsher persecution for a longer period of time than had the West, which had put all sorts of strains on Eastern Christian communities. Differences inherent in the two languages were also significant. Greek is a much subtler language than Latin. Like modern German, it can produce infinite shades of meaning by coining new words out of existing morphological elements. For that reason, it can handle both deliberate and deliberately irresolvable ambiguity on the one hand, and minutely precise distinctions of meaning on the other. Latin is a simpler language, with a smaller vocabulary, and no ancient tradition of new coinages, so one word nearly always had to be used for multiple concepts. It was for that reason poorly suited to the nuances of philosophy and theology, and there had arisen a long tradition of native Latin speakers using Greek in academic discussion and writing. But the sheer suitability of Greek for intellectual endeavour brought hazards when it came to theology. The prospect of salvation in Christianity rested on belief, not on the careful performance of ritual acts. Believing the wrong thing about the Christian God meant putting one's salvation at risk. The kinds of philosophical hair-splitting that had long been the meat and drink of Greek intellectual life became a matter of life and death when placed in the Christian context of salvation. Much as ancient theologians and pious modern scholars, for that matter, could pretend that right belief or orthodoxy was a single truth somewhere out there awaiting the intellection of human minds to discover it, right belief was and is a construct forged in the contestation of rival theologians. Wrong belief might be condemned as heresy, but one churchman's heretic was another guardian of true orthodoxy. Worse still, thanks to Greeks' linguistic proteanism, the moment of a theological formula had resolved one problem and established an uncontested agreement as to its orthodoxy, rare enough as that was. The fact of that agreement opened up new questions in need of resolution, and the whole divisive cycle began again, and was, of course, vastly exacerbated by personal and political rivalries among churchmen, not least those bishops who claimed special spiritual authority for their sees. In 324, the Greek Church was in the midst of one such theological upheaval, disputing precisely how God the Father and God the Son were related to one another in the Christian Trinity of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We call this the Arian controversy, after the Egyptian priest Arius, whose formulae were in dispute. Egypt's main episcopal see of Alexandria, which claimed apostolic foundation by St. Mark the Evangelist, had struggled with the same problem of traditores that had produced the Donatist schism in Africa, but in this dispute, one side had hitched its claims to a genuine theological problem. Arius had been a student at Antioch, Alexandria's greatest rival, and had rejected the Alexandrian bishop's belief that God the Father and God the Son shared a single substance, ousia in Greek, substantia in Latin. Since God the Father had begotten God the Son, there was necessarily some moment at which God the Son had not existed, and if that were so, then God the Son should not share the same substance as God the Father, and must, in fact, be different from and subordinate to him. For this critique, Arius found himself exiled by his bishop and sought support elsewhere in the East. That immediately politicized the intellectual question, and rival networks of bishops sought Constantine's support from the moment he had beaten Licinius. The emperor turned to the same expedient he'd tried in the West, calling a church council to resolve the dispute. This was held in 325 at Nicaea, a location in Asia Minor that could be reached fairly easily by most Eastern bishops, while Constantine ensured that a smattering of Latin bishops attended as well. In the end, more than 300 bishops are said to have been in attendance, including bishops Eustathius of Antioch and Eusebius of Nicomedia, the city that housed the main imperial residence in Asia Minor. In a decision with far-reaching consequences, the bishop of Alexandria, pleading old age, sent in his stead his precociously brilliant deacon and eventual successor, Athanasius. Supporters of Arius, led by Eusebius of Nicomedia, were in a clear minority, though they argued their case well. However, Athanasius was both a theological prodigy and a viciously shrewd politician. After long debate and much calling in of political favours, the council condemned Arius's teaching and mandated a theological formula by which God the Father and God the Son were homoousios, identical in being or substance. Homoousios is a compound of the Greek words for sameness and being. Despite God the Father's having begotten God the Son. The listener may suspect a paradox, but the Nicene formula was good enough to do the immediate work it had to. Almost everyone was satisfied, at least for the moment, even those like Eusebius of Nicomedia, who thought the Homoousian solution intellectually indefensible. Only two bishops joined Arius in his refusal to relent, and the three were duly exiled. The solution pleased the new emperor, a fact that should have benefited everyone, and it would have if Christianity were better able to tolerate differences of belief, but it is not. Athanasius of Alexandria and his allies, including most of the Latin churchmen who may or may not have followed the details of what was really at stake, had a political as well as a theological investment in maintaining the Nicene formula against all comers. Athanasius succeeded to the episcopate of Alexandria in 328, which gave him a formidable power base to match his formidable argumentative skills, and he never hesitated in putting both to use. Many who thought Arius to be wrong, or at least partially wrong, also thought the Homoousian solution to be equally, though differently, wrong. Eusebius of Nicomedia, for instance, favoured a solution by which Father and Son were alike in substance, homoios, but not identical in substance as the Nisaean homoios would have it. Eusebius became a confidant of Constantine as the emperor aged, eventually baptizing him on his deathbed. And the bishop of Nicomedia used his position to fill eastern bishoprics with sympathetic homoians, or Arians as they were caricatured by their Nisaean opponents. Athanasius, a tireless opponent of the Homoans, was not above using dirty tricks to get his way, and blocked as many such appointments as he could, with the result that he found himself exiled by the emperor at the time of Constantine's death. He would remain a disruptive force in Roman politics for decades, not least because Constantine's son Constantius was both an exceptionally pious Christian and an exceptionally convinced Homoan. Constantius expended a great deal of energy and huge amounts of cash and other resources trying to find a variation on the Homoan formula that could unify all the bishops of the empire, calling what he expected to be binding church councils half a dozen times. Antioch, 341, Serdica, 342, Sirmium, 351, Arelate, 353, Mediolanum, 355, Ariminum, and Seleucia, 359, and Constantinople, 360. Each time, he personally intervened in the drafting of creeds he intended to be universally acceptable, and therefore universally enforced. He failed in this ambition every time, in part because the theological differences he was trying to paper over were too wide, in part because partisan politics was deeply entrenched in the post-Nicene episcopate, and in part because the imperial commitment to enforcing orthodoxy made compromise impossible. That is the structural point, and it is a defining aspect of the later Roman Empire. Nicaea and its aftermath made the emperor and his officials responsible for enforcing conformity to one form of Christian belief over another. But while it is in theory possible to enforce conformity of practice, how does one go about enforcing conformity of belief? What Constantine had committed himself and his officials to enforcing was something not open to proof. Christian controversialists understood this and seized upon it for its political utility. In the long run, the state was forced to expand vast resources on defining what people should profess to believe and then compelling them to do so. That created whole populations who were socially and politically marginalized, and at times even persecuted, for refusing to conform to whatever particular Christian formulae a given emperor endorsed. We shall see the negative consequences that this had for imperial unity and the affairs of state time and again as the audiobook progresses. That said, the speed with which disputes about Christian orthodoxy became a central focus of imperial politics also demonstrates the speed with which the empire became Christian after Constantine. Within at most two generations, and probably much sooner, a majority of the imperial population was professing one or another form of Christian belief. Constantine took active measures to favour the church and signal his support for the Christian God, banning crucifixion as a punishment, changing marriage laws to reflect Christian moral teachings, and declaring that no public business apart from agricultural labour should be conducted on the day sacred to the sun, and on which God the Son had been resurrected after his crucifixion, thereby inventing the weekend. Favouring Christians in promotion to higher office was no doubt another important factor in encouraging self-interested conversions. Likewise, finally, the measures Constantine took against non-Christian religions must have had some impact. These were relatively minor, not to say benign, in the western provinces, but in the east, the confiscation of temple treasuries would have a profound effect. Temples had for over a millennium served the Greek world as a hybrid of banks and museums, and Constantine appropriated their gold and their treasures both to fund the new system of gold coinage based on the solidus and to pay for his magnificent new residence at Constantinople, whose Public spaces would be adorned with the treasures of the whole Eastern Empire. The traditional centres of Hellenistic worship thus found themselves impoverished quite suddenly, which probably did more to undermine them than any other Constantinian measure, including one that has roused tremendous scholarly controversy, whether or not Constantine instituted a ban on pagan sacrifice. There is no ironclad contemporary evidence for such a ban, but one of Constantine's sons issued a law banning sacrifice in 341 that states that his father had issued a similar ban in the past. There is other, perhaps less certain, evidence from a poem by Palladas, a contemporary. It is thus quite probable, if not absolutely proven, that Constantine banned pagan sacrifice in public, not just blood sacrifice, but also the symbolic lighting of incense at the shrines of the gods. Rather as in Diocletian's persecution of Christians, enforcement must have depended largely on the attitudes of local officials, and any ban is likely to have done less long-term damage to the old non-Christian cults than the looting of their treasuries. The destination of that loot was Constantinople, the new city on the Bosphorus that Constantine founded on the site of ancient Byzantium, where Europe and Asia meet. He claimed to have had a vision directing him where to build his new city, and that a divinity also helped him lay out its boundaries. Constantinople was a celebration of his victory over Licinius and his new dominion over the whole Roman world, and it rapidly became a symbol of the Christian Empire. The city was ceremoniously founded and its ground broken on the 8th of November 324. 6 years later, it was ready to be occupied, and the dedication took place on the 11th of May 330. Constantine wanted the city to be a second Rome, and it deliberately echoed many aspects of the much older mother of empire. One of the most important aspects of 4th century history is the way in which Constantine's city achieved the hopes it had for it, becoming, by the end of that century, the indisputable capital of the Eastern Empire. The Emperor Constantius II, with whose death we began, did more than any other single person to put Constantinople on the track to dominance, giving it a proper senate and aggrandizing its bishop at the expense of Antioch and Alexandria. Julian, his rebellious cousin and the furious antagonist of Christianity, might have been able to reverse some of the revolutionary impact of Constantine's reign. Certainly, he wanted to do so. But the brevity of his short reign, as the next chapter will show, ensured that he could not. Chapter 2. The Failures of Julian. The Emperor Julian is a source of endless fascination to scholars, not least because his brooding narcissism speaks directly to many academics. But there is also the fact that he impressed himself vividly on some of the most eloquent authors whose works have come down to us. Ammianus Marcellinus, for whom Julian was the heroic centrepiece of history, the Antiochene orator Libanius, who lamented the failure of Julian's programmatic support of the old gods, John Chrysostom, the golden-mouthed Christian bishop who execrated Julian for his insistent paganism, and Ephrem, the Mesopotamian priest whose beautiful Syriac hymns revel in Julian's eventual failure and death. And then there are Julian's own writings, which so convey his personality that they flatter the historian into a sort of complicit intimacy. Julian brings out one's amateur psychoanalyst more than any ancient author save Saint Augustine. And only Augustus and Constantine rival him for the largest number of modern biographies of Roman emperors. All of this is more than a little ironic, because Julian's brief sole reign was a failure at every conceivable level. Indeed, even his staunchest admirers could not conceal the degree to which he alienated other people with his actions. We can hardly explain Julian's failure except by recourse to his mental state. It is as if all his most dangerous impulses were set free when he stopped dissembling his reverence for the old gods and his hatred of Christianity. In Gaul, where he still feared the wrath of his cousin Constantius, he had learned to be a good field commander, and, as he himself tells us, he had read Caesar and Plutarch assiduously in order to improve further. The lightning campaign with which he seized control of the Balkans in the months before Constantius's death was a model of ancient strategic success. But once the threat of his cousin disappeared, he felt the Homeric lure he had absorbed in his happy youth with his eunuch tutor Mardonius, and the shade of Achilles began to whisper in Julian's ear, beckoning him to battle. He would win the Persian War his cousin had cut short, no matter that his preparations for it would soon turn the eastern cities against him. His religious convictions followed a similarly self-destructive path. Several strands of philosophical religion had converged in the Roman Empire of the 3rd century, when the mystical Neoplatonism of Plotinus had become dominant. In the 4th century, they diverged again into the dialectical and philosophical religiosity of Porphyry and the more spectacular mantic religion of Iamblichus. Julian had learned the first sort of Neoplatonism from Eusebius of Myndos and the latter from Maximus of Ephesus, but it was Maximus who had impressed himself more upon Julian's character. Now, unfettered by any constraint, Julian let loose his passion for theurgy and for divination. The costly excesses that he lavished on these pleasures repelled ordinary Greeks and Romans, and not just Christians, but pagans as well. Julian began from the moment he learned of Constantius's death, with Aquileia still up in arms against him, sending his magister equitum, that is, his second-ranking general, Flavius Jovinus, to convince the Aquilean legions to surrender, the new emperor launched a volley of open letters to the various cities of the east. In these, and in the ones he sent to close spiritual advisers like Maximus, he declared his intention of restoring the worship of the pagan gods. Travelling on via Philippopolis and Heraclea to Constantinople, he arrived at the imperial city on the 11th of December 361. There, one of his first concerns was to order the construction of a mithraeum in honour of the heroic saviour god Mithras, whose worship he approved, and to suppress, insofar as he could, the worship of the Christian saviour god whom he loathed. And in ironic imitation of the metropolitan episcopal structure of the Christian church, he began to appoint his favourite philosophers as provincial priests of the old gods. Julian's trusted advisor, Salutius Secundus, was made praetorian prefect of Oriens and put in charge of a series of high-profile treason trials. These were held in the city of Chalcedon, across the Bosphorus from Constantinople, and less prone to riot. The trials became a way for the new emperor's Western High Command to prosecute old feuds with those who had served Constantius. We find alongside Salutius some of the most powerful men in the Western establishment, the Comes Sacrarum Largitionum and newly appointed prefect of Illyricum, Claudius Marmatinus, the Magister Peditum Agilo, the Magister Equitum Nevita, and the Magister Equitum Jovinus, who had served beside the Caesar Julian in Gaul and then backed his winning bid against his cousin. Yet we also find Flavius Arbitio, a leading general in the 350s, now retired and a long-standing enemy of Julian's, but too powerful a figure in the Western establishment to ignore. The commission did the work expected of it. Some of Constantius's officials, especially those thought to have been complicit in the fall of Julian's half-brother Gallus, were exiled, others were killed, including the praepositus sacri cubiculi Eusebius, widely hated as both a eunuch and a secret power broker. The notorious Argentes in Rebus, Appidemius, and Paulus Catina, Paul the Chain, who had sown terror among senators and bureaucrats alike during Constantius's last decade, were burned alive. Other executions stirred up criticism, however, and some thought Julian had gone too far. The new year of 362 opened with two of Julian's staunchest supporters, Marmatinus and Nevita, taking up the consular fasces and giving their names to the year. The Romans had no sequential system of numbering years, instead referring to the year when such and such were consuls. Flavius Jovinus returned to Gaul as Magister Equitum. Julian needed a trustworthy figure to hold the West for him while he secured control of the Greek world and tried to impose his anti-Christian policies on the empire. From the very beginning of the year, his efforts to harm the church stepped up. Early in February, he issued a law ordering the return of all those bishops who had been exiled by Constantius for their Nicene beliefs. Knowing that this was a sure recipe for disrupting Christian congregations across the empire. Only in May did he set out from Constantinople en route to Antioch and the war against Persia. This war would be for his glory and for the good of his loyal pagan subjects, but not for the Christians. He refused an embassy from the people of Nisibis, Nusaybin in modern Turkey, who were Christians, instead asking for their aid against Persia on the grounds that they were defying his orders to reopen the pagan temples. It is no mere coincidence that some of the most virulent attacks on Julian should come from a native of Nisibis, the Syrian Ephraim. The route Julian took across Asia Minor was conceived, it is clear, as a pilgrimage of sorts. From Chalcedon to Nicomedia, he went on to Nicaea, making a detour to worship at the shrine of the mother goddess Magna Mater at Pessinus. Then, via Ankara, he travelled east to Tyana, where he venerated the memory of the wonderworker Apollonius, whose 3rd century biographer Philostratus had portrayed him as a pagan counterpoint to Jesus. He arrived at Antioch early in June, and there he remained until March of the following year. He livened his days with monumental orgies of blood sacrifice, and by stirring up the rabid infighting of the city's Christians. Believing that the oracle of Apollo at Daphne had ceased to speak because the remains of the Christian martyr Babylas were revered nearby, he had the bones exhumed, sparking Christian protests and a grand procession demanding the saint's reinterment. To further discomfort the faith that he hated, Julian offered imperial patronage to the Jews. The treasury would provide funds to restore the temple in Jerusalem, where Jews had not been allowed to set foot since the time of Hadrian and the suppression of the Jewish revolt under Bar Kokhba. That project would fail, as mysterious fires repeatedly halted construction. Though Christians took these as a sign of divine support, it is likely that Christian arsonists made their own luck. Another fire, which destroyed Apollo's shrine in Antioch itself, was eventually found to be an accident, though Julian initially blamed the Christians, who entirely reciprocated the hatred he felt for them. Yet Antioch's pagans were only marginally more pleased with their emperor now that they had a chance to see him up close. He avoided giving the circus games that provided holidays and entertainment for favoured cities, and he paid no attention to the action when he finally put some on, a food shortage caused in part by crop failure and in part by the needs of his campaign army angered others, and everyone could find an outlet for their resentment in the vast holocausts of cattle that he offered up to his various pagan gods. He was jokingly called the victimarius, or slaughterer, rather than priest, and his short height and devotion to his long philosopher's beard added to the ridicule, some calling him a dwarf and an ape. His brittle ego wounded, Julian found the Antonines' resentment of him intolerable. In January or February 363, which he had opened with his 4th consulship in the company of the Gallic Praetorian prefect Flavius Sallustius, he unleashed a ferocious satire on himself that was meant to terrify the citizens of Antioch. Read out like any other imperial pronouncement, it was then posted for public display on the tetrapylon of the elephants, a monumental triumphal arch in the centre of Antioch. This lacerating pamphlet, known as the Misopogon or Beard Hater, showers vitriol on Julian and on his Antonine subjects, whose morality, frivolity, and lack of respect are castigated without let up. But while mocking himself, he also reveals the depth of his self-regard and a firm conviction that everything he is doing is right. Given how few of his subjects of any religious persuasion shared that view, it is unsurprising that he gave up on trying to satisfy them and instead turned to the long-heralded invasion of Persia. The previous December, Julian had refused an offer of peace put forward by ambassadors of the Shahanshah Shapur II. The latter had troubles elsewhere in his empire with which he needed to deal. Persia's central Asian provinces of Sogdiana and Bactria, and perhaps also the so-called Kushanshahar in modern Pakistan, had been invaded by confederations of nomad aristocrats, disrupting royal administration. These nomads all claimed a sort of kinship with the ancient Xiongnu, a powerful steppe empire on the frontiers of China around the turn of the millennium. The Xiongnu legacy was a potent organizing ideology on the steppe, and we shall come across many more such groups in the course of this audiobook, not least the steppe warriors we know best as the Huns. Whatever relationship the 4th century invaders of Persia's eastern provinces had to the Huns we meet in Ukraine and the Danube Basin in the late 4th century, they set up a dynamic that would plague the Persian kings for the rest of antiquity, constantly putting them on the defensive in one distant corner of the empire or another, and often at bad moments that the Romans were only too happy to exploit. Late in 362, despite the favourable terms Shapur was offering, Julian knew that he held a trump card that made compromise unnecessary. Shapur's brother Ormazd had been in exile among the Romans since the mid-320s, and this Sasanian prince, whose royal lineage was impeccable, had long been a companion to Constantius, present even at that emperor's triumphal entry to Rome in 357. Julian's ambition was to put Ormazd on the Persian throne in place of his brother Shapur, and the military plan was both elaborate and plausible. One Roman force, under a distant relative of the Constantinian dynasty called Procopius, led an army north to the borders of Armenia, where he joined forces with the Armenian king Arsaces and constructed an elaborate feint against Persian territory. Meanwhile, Julian led the main army out of Antioch via Carrhae, Callinicum, and Circesium, where the historian Armanius joined the expedition on the 1st of April, thereafter to narrate events as an eyewitness. From Circesium, the army reached Zaitha and half-derelict Dura Europus on the Euphrates, where a fleet carried supplies downriver as the army marched on Ctesiphon. The northern feint worked. The larger part of the Persian army was dispatched towards Armenia, and Julian got as far south as Narmalka, the canal linking the Euphrates to the Tigris near Ctesiphon, with little opposition. Minor skirmishes, the surrender of several fortresses, and the successful siege of Myosemalka by the commanders Dagalyphus and Nevita, the former consul, spurred Julian onwards. Taken by surprise, Shapur's commanders cut the canal dikes and flooded the countryside, slowing the Roman advance at a critical juncture. When the Roman army reached the Persian capital in June, Ctesiphon had been heavily reinforced, and the flooded countryside made it impossible to feed a besieging force. Ammianus, having seen it himself, portrays the unravelling of the invasion with a tragic inevitability. Realizing that they could not safely return the way they had come, and perhaps deceived into thinking that the army could live off the land while marching north up the banks of the Tigris, Julian burned his transport ships on the Euphrates, and with them many of his army supplies. Abandoning Ctesiphon without a siege, the Roman army began to withdraw. But Shapur had recovered from the original deception and, marching south at speed, caught Julian's army just as its retreat was getting underway. Rather than fight an unnecessary pitched battle, he simply harassed the fringes of the Roman army as they made their laborious way out of Persian territory. Julian refused the offer of a treaty, finding the very thought humiliating. That was a mistake, for the beleaguered army was moving slowly. Every day brought more casualties, while Persian skirmishers made it difficult to gather fodder and food safely. Then, on the morning of the 26th of June, one of the Persians' ceaseless raids had an unexpected denouement. Taken by surprise, a section of the Roman army was scattered, and Julian rushed from his tent to rally the troops, neglecting to put on his armour. He and his bodyguard of Praetores drove off the raid and went in pursuit. But a javelin thrown by one of the Persians' Arab auxiliaries struck Julian in the side. As he tried to pull it out, he severed the tendons in his hand and fell from his horse, pouring with blood. In great pain, and obviously dying, he was carried back to camp. Ammianus closed the deathbed scene in literary tropes drawn from the lives of the great Greek heroes. When the pain lessens, Julian demands his armour and weapons to once more rally his troops, just as the dying Theban hero Epaminondas had done at the Battle of Mantinea. When that proves impossible, he discourses on the sublimity of the human spirit with his closest companions, the philosophers Maximus and Priscus. Some suspect Ammianus of invention, as indeed one might. But Julian, a fantasist to the end, could well have performed just such a script from the classic books that had comforted him in his lonely adolescence. He died that morning, as did many others, including Anatolius, the Magister Officiorum, although the prefect Salutius Secundus made a lucky escape. The soldiers, enraged by their losses, won a battlefield victory, and Ammianus's account records the number of senior Persian generals killed that day. But this small success was momentary. The camp fell into despair.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.